On January 4th of 2019, after a night out, a 22-year-old mother of four was reported missing. 6 months later, her body would be found buried in a nearby farm. This is the infuriating case of David Sparks. Hello, friend, and welcome to High Time Crime. My name's Joel, and on here I specialize in true crime and also wearing extremely large pants. What can I say? They're super comfy. But today, we're going over the case of David Sparks. You're going to learn about the terrible and cruel actions of a self-professed psychopath and what true evil looks like. For our story, we're visiting Lexington, Kentucky, the horse capital of the world. With a population of over 322,000 people, Lexington is the second most populous city in the entire state. What it's most well known for is its horse farms and thoroughbred racetracks such as Keeneland. It has a long, storied history, and the people there are interesting and fun. If you ever find yourself in or around this city, there's no shortage of exciting activities to partake in. You could visit the Kentucky Horse Park and see a bunch of horses, or take a stroll through the American Saddlebred Museum. You could head over to the Mary Todd Lincoln House and enter the childhood home of Abraham Lincoln's wife. You could go to the Lexington Brewing and Distilling Company and try out some different brews. You could even take your kids, or yourself, to the Explorium of Lexington, where a giant model of human teeth can be found. But unfortunately, none of these exhilarating activities are the reason as to why we're there today. Savannah Marie Spurlock was born on February 5th of 1996 to her parents Ellen and Cecil David Spurlock. After graduating from Madison Central High School in 2014, she later attended Eastern Kentucky University in Richmond, where she studied health administration. Throughout her life, she worked various different jobs in the restaurant industry, and in the summer, she loved to serve as a lifeguard. Almost everything for Savannah was about servicing and helping others. She was energetic, funny, and very loving. Some of her favorite activities included cooking, playing games, and hanging out with her friends. With four kids, including two toddlers and two newborns, Savannah took on a lot of responsibility for herself at a young age. But luckily, she was very mentally resilient and had a considerable degree of help from her family. She lived with her mother Ellen and her sister Stephanie in Richmond, Kentucky. And the father of the three of her children was a man by the name of Shaquille Smith. Savannah and Shaquille had previously been in a long-term relationship starting in 2015, but they eventually separated and went their separate ways in March of 2018. The two of them still remained on relatively good terms, though, and by late 2018, Savannah was once again pregnant with more of his children. Then in December of that same year, she gave birth to a beautiful set of twin boys. And while bringing more life into this world was certainly her calling, around the beginning of 2019, Savannah's mother said that she began experiencing a little bit of a rough patch. Talking to her grandmother, Savannah described a vision of what she wanted for herself: a secure job and her own apartment for her and her kids. But for now, she needed a break. 5 weeks after giving birth, she soon found it in the form of a night out. Now, while she typically didn't go out that much, according to her mother, on the night of January 4th, her and one of her girlfriends decided to take the 30-minute drive up to Lexington to go visit a bar. So at 9 p.m. that night, Savannah took her mom's car to her friend's house, and together the two of them met up with another friend, a male, at his house in Lexington. Shortly after, the three of them then rode in the male's friend's car to a location in the city known as the Other Bar, meanwhile leaving her mom's car at the male friend's house. Inside of the bar, the three friends became acquainted with new people, and they started to have a lot of fun. However, it didn't remain that way throughout the rest of the night. After informing the group that he had to get up early for work, Savannah's male friend soon left, leaving Savannah and her girlfriend alone with a bunch of random guys. And then later in the evening, after a few more drinks, Savannah and the girlfriend she came with got into a huge argument, so she ended up leaving too, while Savannah stayed around to hang out with her new acquaintances. Around 2:30 a.m. the next morning, Savannah was then seen on surveillance walking out of the bar with three other guys. At 3 a.m., her mother Ellen woke up in a panic after noticing that her daughter hadn't returned home yet. Quickly, she picked up her phone and FaceTimed Savannah, but the call ended right away, and so she tried again a few minutes later. The two of them then spoke on the phone again, and by now, Ellen could see during the call that her daughter was in a car with a couple of other men and clearly intoxicated. However, because Savannah told her mother that she was fine and that she would be home by the morning, they soon ended the call, and that was that. Finally, at 8:30 a.m. that morning, Savannah's cell phone went out of service, and her mother's phone call was the last time anyone heard from her outside of the three men she left the bar with. From this point forward, Savannah Spurlock would go missing. The next 6 months were agonizing for all of Savannah's friends and family. The same morning of her disappearance, her mother Ellen was in a panic after her daughter failed to come home when she said she would. Immediately, she got on the phone and started calling every one of Savannah's friends to see if they knew where she was. One of the people she called was her daughter's best friend, Sabrina Spiritos. Sabrina was the godmother of all four of Savannah's kids, and the two of them had been friends for a long time, but even she agreed that it wasn't like Savannah to just go off and disappear like that. Soon after Ellen had finished talking to Sabrina and a few others, she still came up short in terms of information, so she ultimately resorted to filing a missing persons report with the local police department. Following this unfortunate step, there was a genuinely awe-inspiring effort on behalf of all of Savannah's friends and family to help find her. They put up flyers around town, they created a Facebook page, they made thousands of posts on social media, started a hashtag, printed out t-shirts, and raised money. And on top of all of this, they had help from both the police and half a dozen additional organizations dedicated to tracking her down. Savannah's family and friends helped to look after her kids, and when her 23rd birthday rolled around in February, they had a small celebration. But in the end, all of this effort would end up coming short. Before we get into exactly why, though, let's talk about the official police investigation into Savannah's missing persons case and how it all led to a farm out in rural Kentucky. So starting shortly after she was reported missing, the local authorities assigned to the case began their official search for Savannah Spurlock, along with a criminal investigation into those that may have been responsible for her disappearance. In their search, they were immediately able to come up with three potential suspects, the same three men who were seen with Savannah on the set of images provided by surveillance cameras. All of them were then interviewed by police, and the story they told investigators was relatively similar. The first two, a couple of African-American men, claimed that the four of them, Savannah and the three men, first left the bar, then drove 40 minutes to a rural home in Garrett County, Kentucky, and there they continued to get drunk. The rural home and its adjacent farm slash woodland property belonged to the family of a 23-year-old man named David Sparks. After partying for a bit, Savannah soon became so intoxicated that she began floating in and out of consciousness. During these lapses in judgment, David kept touching Savannah inappropriately, but despite seeing this, the two men refused to do anything about it and eventually left, leaving Savannah alone with a man she didn't even know. When asked why they would leave her alone with David instead of staying to make sure she was okay, they told investigators that they didn't think he would end up hurting her.
Do you think David would have had any reason to do anything to Savannah?
I don't think so.
Is she alive when you leave the house?
Yeah, most definitely, yeah. You sure we should let that girl there? I'm like, yeah, why? I don't know, he's like, David really, really want to f***. You know, do you know, like, seriously, do you know what's going on? What she at, whatever? He's adamant, no, I don't know where she's at.
Do you believe him?
70-30.
Really, guys? Really? How pathetic. They also talked to investigators about David's personality, and here's what they said.
David, weird.
Oh, yeah, he's a weirdo. Everybody knew that. I mean, He's got unorthodox, like, thinking. I mean, some certain things he do is just, like, different than others. He's paranoid.
Anyway, after interviewing these two men, the police eventually got around to talking to David Sparks himself. Now, at the time, David was 23 years old. He was the son of a pastor, and he lived in a house right up the street from his parents' property in Garrett County. Not much is known about his past or early life, but during the time he was suspected of being responsible for Savannah's disappearance, he already had a pretty lengthy criminal record. This included things from as simple as traffic violations to the more serious crimes of driving under the influence, operating on a suspended or revoked license, possession of the good green, and buying or possessing paraphernalia. Police also found him to be a little creepy.
There was something about him that just kind of made the hair on the back of your neck stand up when you talk to him.
During David's first interview with police, he claimed that he had no knowledge of Savannah's whereabouts, and that the sequence of events that occurred on the morning of Savannah's disappearance was as follows. First, Savannah, David, and the two other men drove to David's family's house in Garrett County. Then they continued drinking. Next, Savannah and David both fell asleep. Later, she woke up, asked where she was, David told her the address. And finally, David fell back to sleep, and when he woke up, she was gone. Here's a bit of that interview.
I got up and she wasn't there, my door was unlocked, and she was gone.
Now, obviously, David's story doesn't make any sense for various different reasons. But namely, the fact that Savannah's car was still parked at her friend's house in Lexington, and unless she took a taxi or something, she had no way of leaving David's house. Theoretically, she could have called a friend to pick her up, but we already know that she didn't contact any friends the morning of her disappearance. And yet ultimately, despite these facts, all three men, including David, were released after being interviewed, and for now, no charges were made in the case of Savannah Spurlock. However, David was now the main suspect of the investigation. And it makes sense because here's a suspicious-looking guy with a criminal record, and he was the last one to see Savannah alive. But at this point, police still needed more evidence. Now, not long after their interrogation with David, police acquired two search warrants. One to investigate his parents' home, and another to investigate the house that he lived in a little bit further up the street. All of this took place in Lancaster, Kentucky, on and around a location called Fall Lick Road. In the end, the results of both of these searches was even more frustrating than the interrogation itself. After entering the properties with a huge search party and searching the premises thoroughly, police failed to uncover any evidence that could link Savannah's disappearance to David Sparks. While they did find a couple of items they thought could be related to the investigation, such as a piece of cloth similar to Savannah's dress and a pair of shoes, none of these ended up matching her outfit. They also towed David's car. Later on, police would have regrets about this search because of David's bizarre behavior when they were observing an area around a strawberry patch. But as we all know, hindsight is 20/20.
That's something that I ask myself actually still when I think about Savannah is how did I not find her? I actually stood on the strawberry patch. Like where it was.
So after failing to come up with anything definitive from the search in and around the Sparks family properties, police and others continued their investigations with a fervor. By now, Savannah had been gone for several months, and search parties were performing full-scale searches everywhere they could think of to look. And while some turned up evidence, others were dead ends. There were aerial searches, searches of nearby bum piles, and at one point, an hours-long search at a landfill for possible discarded evidence. Also, the case of Savannah Spurlock has since achieved mass media attention, and the hashtag her friends had developed, Savannah Strong, was still going strong. But in the meantime, her friends and family were in a state of not-so-quiet desperation. While this was all ongoing, David Sparks was also in a state of desperation all on his own. According to information that came out later on, David's search history was littered with searches about the case of Savannah Spurlock using the term Richmond Missing Mom over and over again. In addition, he was becoming increasingly paranoid about the police, and this even bled into his daily life. including his conversations with others. During one Snapchat exchange with a friend, someone asked him if the police had been going after the two other men as much as they had been going after David, to which David responded, "Yeah, they was at first, but they sort of got cleared. I was admittedly the last person to see her, so yeah, they've been on my app. I'm talking, my phone is tapped, my car is tapped, they followed me everywhere, talked to girls I used to talk to. They tried to get my buddy from work to wear a wire around me and get me to start talking about the situation. Shit's been crazy. They profiled me as a psychopath." Wonder why they would think that he was a psychopath. Anyways, 6 months into the disappearance of their daughter, Savannah, the Spurlock family decided to hire a private investigator. He was soon in the process of familiarizing himself with the case and the local area and getting everything prepared for an extensively thorough investigation. But before this could even happen, the family soon received tragic news that made all of that unnecessary. The same type of news that no parent ever wants to receive. On July 10th of 2019, investigators got a tip from David's father that there was an extremely unpleasant smell coming from a strawberry patch on their family farm. By this point, David had moved back in with his parents after previously living up the street. Immediately after the call, police acquired another search warrant to investigate the property, and a team of investigators, led by Detective Ty Chavies, then made the 40-minute drive up to Lancaster to visit the property. When they got there, they identified the location of the smell and quickly began digging around the area. Soon after, they finally discovered the whereabouts of Savannah Spurlock. She was lying dead, wrapped in a rug, only 18 inches deep in the ground, all around the same area that police had already searched. Around the same time as this awful discovery, David Sparks was now turning himself in. He had pulled up to the parking lot of the Richmond Police Department, locked his keys in his car, and told the authorities that he would need a public defender. He was then arrested on charges including of a corpse and tampering with physical evidence. What then followed after the discovery of Savannah's body and the arrest of David Sparks was an outpouring of grief and justified anger. The hashtag #SavannahStrong was soon accompanied by Justice for Savannah and others. And on the Facebook page for her disappearance, her aunt posted a heartfelt statement thanking everyone who helped search for her.
"We are heartbroken to confirm that Savannah's remains were found on the property of a home in Garrett County overnight. Our sobs of pain and physical anguish are met with moments of our beautiful memories of the vibrant and vivacious person she was. She lives on through her precious boys, who each carry a special part of her in them. We know that Savannah has not been suffering all of this time. She has been cradled in the arms of our great Savior, Jesus Christ. We could not have done this without the over 35,000 of you on this page who have followed, shared, prayed, searched, donated, and advocated. You have kept Savannah's silenced voice alive along with us in a fight for the truth. You have embraced a stranger with empathy and compassion. Many of you have adopted her into your family as one of your own. Thank you."
During David Sparks' probable cause hearing on July 15th of 2019, Detective Chavies described the moment he discovered the body of Savannah Spurlock during his testimony.
"Were you present when her body was unearthed?"
"I was."
"Tell His Honor what you saw."
"Your Honor, I observed, with the assistance of the FBI special or evidence response team, the body was exhumed from a clandestine grave. That body was concealed within multiple black trash bags. The body was unclothed. The feet were bound with tape, and the body was in an unnatural position. And by that, I mean her head and feet were in the same position. She was folded over in half."
"Okay. Did you find anything lying next to her body, against her body?"
"I did."
"What did you find?"
"It was what I would describe as an accent rug, rectangular in shape, grayish in color."
Now, after checking the strawberry patch, police later searched David's home, and there they found a bunch of other evidence used to indict and later convict David in the murder. This included a blood stain on the wall and a strange note he wrote sometime after killing Savannah, which I will now read to you the contents of. "I simply don't care at all. I feel no true love for anything. Now that I know what I really am, I see a greater need to hide my true self, but I just want to be free. I stay in a constant state of aggression. Nothing seems to help anymore. I have an abyss for a soul that sucks every attempt to make myself whole. I want my family to understand, maybe just to excuse my actions over the years. But how do you look your mother in the eyes and tell her you are a born psychopath? That she gave birth to a monster. Someone who wouldn't care a bit to squeeze the last breath out of another human or plunge a knife into their chest and smile about it. My mother, the only person in the world that I never want to disappoint, yet I see it on her face every day. What do I do? They also gained access to his cell phone, and that had a lot of evidence on it too. This included the Snapchats we already mentioned earlier and text messages between him and his sister talking about where to buy a new rug, not long after Savannah's disappearance. Apparently, the one that was buried with Savannah matched the original one from his room. He used it to bury Savannah and then got a replacement. Police later acquired surveillance footage of him buying the new rug. And lastly, all of David's walls showed evidence of being thoroughly scrubbed down with cleaning supplies. As for the cause of death for Savannah, that was never officially determined because by the time the police had found her body, it was too decomposed. Although initially, David pleaded not guilty, the evidence became too overwhelming, and so he confessed to everything and took a plea deal. While in his cell at the Lincoln County Detention Center, he drew an extremely disturbing image of two women, and this led to him being transferred to Southeast State Correctional Complex upon waiting for his trial to commence. It also generated questions whether or not there may have been other victims, not including Savannah. Later on, the trial of David Sparks itself was extremely frustrating for the prosecution because it kept getting delayed. And in the end, Savannah's family and friends were forced to watch David's conviction on Zoom. An unsatisfying end, to say the least, but fortunately, he was convicted on all three charges and sentenced to 50 years in prison with the possibility of parole in 20 years. The latter part I doubt he'll ever get, simply because by then Savannah's children will be old enough to make sure it doesn't happen. All of this took place on December 17th of 2020. Personally, I don't think 50 years is enough. Why not life? Savannah was a sweet, kind mother of four who truly didn't deserve what happened to her. All she wanted was to improve her life and to create a better future for her kids. In the end, she took some time off from this for a single night, and she couldn't even have that. But it's okay because she's in a great place and resting peacefully. As for David Sparks, the vile psychopathic piece of sh**, well, I hope he stays in jail for a long, long time. And if God wills it, maybe he'll be there for the rest of his life. Just like Savannah will be in the hearts and minds of all of her friends and family for the rest of their lives. But anyways, thank you for watching this episode of High Time Crime. If true crime is your thing, then please subscribe and hit the like button because that's all we do. I also have a second account with my brother named Horrifying, where we tell stories about everything paranormal. This includes true crime, mysteries, and things that are just downright spooky. I'd greatly appreciate if you subscribe to that too. I hope you have a great rest of your day. Take care, friend.